Hello friends, I am Ravi Verma. I welcome you to SR Concepts. Thank you for watching and liking my videos. Please subscribe to the channel and hit the bell icon for future notifications. This is part 5th of a series of videos on the topic Cell, the Fundamental Unit of Life. In part 4th, I have discussed about the plasma membrane and the cell wall and some processes related to them. In this video, I will be discussing about the remaining topics of the structure of the cell. Our first topic will be the nucleus. So let's start learning. Right? Look at this image. A nucleus of eukaryotic cells is shown. Right? And this nucleus is covered by a membrane known as nuclear membrane. Some pores are there known as nuclear pores. And some material is present inside the nuclear membrane. This whole material is called a nucleoplasm, right? Now let's understand what is nucleus. Now look at this diagram. This is an animal cell and this is a bacterial cell, right? And this rounded pink structure is representing the nucleus of the animal cell. And this coiled thread-like structure is representing the nucleus of a bacterial cell. Actually, nucleus is found in every type of cell. It is found in bacterial cells, plant cells, animal cells, and fungal cells. Dear students, nucleus of plant cells, animal cells, and fungal cells are similar in one aspect. And the nucleus of these three types of cells is somehow different from the bacterial nucleus. Right? Look. This is an animal cell and this is a bacterial cell, right? Here you can see that the nucleus of animal cell has a covering, a membrane around it. This membrane is called nuclear membrane. But here you can see there is no membrane around the nucleus. Actually, nucleus contains genetic material, which is also called the chromosomes or chromatin fibers. In bacterial cells, you can see there is a long thread-like structure at the center. This thread-like structure is the chromosome of the bacterial cell, right? So the nucleus of the bacterial cell is represented by the chromosome of the bacterial cell. So this chromosome is the nucleus of bacterial cell and this is called nucleoid. Nucleoid, right? Now the nucleus of animal cell, bacterial cell, sorry, nucleus cell, nucleus of animal cells, plant cells, and fungal cells, it has chromosomes, right? But the chromosomes are covered by two membranes which are known as nuclear membranes or nuclear envelope. In this way, we can say that bacterial nucleus is not covered by nuclear membrane, but the nucleus of plant cells, animal cells, and fungal cells is covered by nuclear membrane. The nucleus of bacterial cells is called poorly defined nucleus, and the nucleus of these three types of cells is called well-defined nucleus. So these cells, the animal cells, the plant cells, and fungal cells, which have well-defined nucleus and which is covered by the nuclear envelope, such cells are called eukaryotic cells. Eukaryotic cells, right? But the bacterial cells in which nucleus is not covered by any envelope, such a nucleus is called poorly defined nucleus, and such cells which have poorly defined nucleus are called prokaryotic cells. Prokaryotic cells, so bacterial cells are called prokaryotic cells. Okay. Now, nucleus is a very important part of every cell. Now, what are the functions of the nucleus? Let us understand. Functions of the nucleus are that it plays a central role in cellular reproduction, that is cell division, the process by which a single cell divides and forms two new cells. Okay, next function is that nucleus plays a very important or crucial part along with the environment in determining the form and functions of the cell, that it will exhibit its maturity by directing, regulating the chemical activities of the cell. Hence the nucleus is called brain of the cell. In other words, if we say, then nucleus is the master of the cell or the brain of the cell, you can say. Why? Because its function is to control and regulate all the activities, all the functions of the cell. It also controls growth of the cell, division of the cell, and not only this, the nucleus plays a very important role in transferring the information or the characteristics from parents to offsprings during reproduction. Right? So this much important is the nucleus. That's why the nucleus is called brain of the cell. Now, how will you understand these all points, these all things? How does the nucleus controls the activities of the cell? How does it control the growth and the reproduction or the cell division of the cell? So let's have a brief discussion over this. Right, first of all, you know that nucleus in eukaryotic cell is covered by membranes known as nuclear membranes or nuclear envelope. Right, so this is nuclear envelope. It has pores known as nuclear pores. Inside it there is a nucleoplasm, and in nucleoplasm the main functional structure of the nucleus is the chromosomes. Chromosomes are in form of some fibrous structures. These fibrous structures are called the chromatin fibers or the chromosomes. Okay, now every chromosome, suppose this is a chromosome, right? Every chromosome is made up of two components. One is the DNA, which is a thread-like chemical molecule, right? This thread-like chemical molecule is highly coiled because of some proteins attached to it. Right, so we can say that chromosome is made up of two chemicals. One is DNA and other is protein. Now, chromosome is the main functional part of the nucleus. Right, and in a particular chromosome, DNA is the main functional part and protein plays a role only in binding of the DNA, coiling of the DNA. So now let's understand, how does a nucleus work? How do chromosomes play an important role in the function of the nucleus? Right? As you know that chromosome is made up of thread-like structure known as DNA. You must have listened the term gene. What are genes? Genes are the segments of DNA. Each such segment, suppose that this segment is gene 1, right? This is second gene, this is the third gene, right? So the functional segments of DNA are called genes. Now, every gene controls one particular chemical activity inside the cell. How does it control? Every gene has a code in it. This code gives direction to the cell to produce an enzyme. So different genes give code for different enzymes, right? Suppose that this was the enzyme 1 coded by gene 1. Right, enzyme 2 coded by gene 2, enzyme 3 coded by gene 3, right? Now, what is enzyme? Look, gene 1, suppose that has the direction to produce enzyme 1, right? What is enzyme? Enzyme itself is a protein molecule, and enzyme is such a protein molecule which speeds up a chemical reaction, a specific chemical reaction. So in this way, enzyme is a protein which controls or speeds up a chemical reaction or chemical activity inside the cell. You know that many chemical activities are going on. For example, production of some protein, production of some lipid, production of some carbohydrate, production of some vitamin. These all processes are actually taking place in the form of chemical reactions, right? In the same way, one more example I can give for a chemical reaction. For example, respiration. Respiration is also a chemical reaction in which glucose reacts with oxygen, right, and then breaks down into carbon dioxide and water along with energy, right? So for this chemical reaction also, there will be some enzyme. So in a cell, a large number of different chemical reactions take place, and every chemical reaction is controlled by an enzyme, and every enzyme is coded by a separate gene. In this way, we can say that chromosomes contain genes, different genes. Different genes code for different enzymes, and different enzymes control different chemical reactions or chemical activities of the cell. These chemical activities are actually the functions which a cell performs, right? So in this way, we can say that all chemical activities or all the functions of the cell are controlled by the nucleus, because nucleus contains chromosomes, chromosome contains gene, genes are made up of DNA, every gene codes for an enzyme, and every enzyme controls a particular chemical reaction. So this is all about the nucleus, right? So nucleus also plays an important role in cell division and also in transfer of characteristics from parents to offsprings. Okay, hope you understand how does a nucleus work. Now let's understand what are prokaryotic cells. I have already described that the bacterial cells are called prokaryotic cells. Examples are bacteria, cyanobacteria and mycoplasma. Actually, mycoplasma and cyanobacteria, these two are the two different categories of bacteria, right? So we can say all the bacterial cells are prokaryotic cells. Why? Because prokaryotic cells have two important features. One feature is that their chromosome is single and not covered by a nuclear envelope. So the nucleus is not covered by a nuclear envelope. Such a nucleus is called poorly defined nucleus, right? And such cells which have a poorly defined nucleus without a nuclear envelope are called prokaryotic cells. This was the first feature of prokaryotic cells, first and important feature, right? So pro means primitive and karyotic means nucleus, okay? So cells with the primitive nucleus are called prokaryotic cells. Second feature is that there is no membrane bound organelles in a bacterial cell. Look at this picture. This is a bacterial cell. You can see that the nucleus is not covered by any membrane. Such a nucleus is a poorly defined nucleus and is called nucleoid. Please note this term. This is a very important term, right? And you can see there are no membrane bound organelles. Now look at this is an animal cell. Animal cell here, you can see the nucleus is covered by the membrane. So this is well-defined nucleus. So this is an eukaryotic cell. Eukaryotic cells like plant, animal and fungal cells, they have many cell organelles which are bound by membranes. For example, Golgi apparatus, endoplasmic reticulum, mitochondria, lysosomes, right? So such cells, the eukaryotic cells have a well-defined nucleus and membrane-bound organelles, right? So there is a table Here you can see in this table we can understand the features of prokaryotic and eukaryotic cells. First, look at the size. Size of prokaryotic cells is small, which is 1 to 10 micrometer. Eukaryotic cells have a larger size usually, which may range from 5 micrometer to 100 micrometer. For example, if we talk about human red blood cells, right? The red blood cells found in our blood, its size is 7 micrometer. Next important point, the nuclear region is poorly defined in prokaryotic cells, and it is without nuclear membrane and it is called nucleoid. Okay, in prokaryotic cell, the nucleus is poorly defined. In eukaryotic cells, it is a well-defined nucleus which is surrounded by nuclear membrane. Next, membrane-bound cell organelles are absent. Membrane-bound cell organelles like mitochondria, chloroplasts are present. Another important point is that the bacterial cells have only a single chromosome. And this single chromosome is actually a circular DNA molecule which does not have any open end. So we can say the chromosome is single and circular, right? But in eukaryotic cells, there are multiple chromosomes, and these chromosomes are in the form of many linear threads. So we can say that in eukaryotic cells, there are multiple chromosomes which are linear thread-like, okay? In prokaryotic cells, the examples are bacteria. Mycoplasma may be called a type of bacteria, right? Eukaryotic cells are plant cells, animal cells, fungal cells, and protozoa cells. The important point is that prokaryotic cells evolved or developed first on this earth. Later, the eukaryotic cells developed from prokaryotic cells. So, prokaryotic cells are of earlier origin and eukaryotic cells are of later origin. So, eukaryotic cells are advanced cells, right? You can take the screenshot and make the notes from it. So our next topic is cytoplasm, right? What is cytoplasm? As already discussed with you, that the cell has a plasma membrane. This is the plasma membrane and this is the nucleus. So all the material between the plasma membrane and the nucleus is called cytoplasm, right? Cytoplasm is a mixture of a large number of chemicals, and a large number of chemical activities take place inside the cytoplasm. Cytoplasm has two portions. There is a ground substance which is called cytosol, and in that substance a large number of structures called cell organelles are suspended, right? So cell organelles, actually, for example, if we talk about mitochondria, that is a cell organelle, right? Cell organelle provides a separate environment for a particular chemical reaction. For example, if we talk about mitochondria, right? So mitochondria is providing a separate room, separate place for chemical reactions of respiration to take place, right? In the same way, we talk about a chloroplast, then chloroplast again is providing a separate room, a separate place for the chemical reactions of photosynthesis or food synthesis in plant cells, right? Now the cell organelles perform specific functions for cells, right? So every different cell organelle perform a different function. There are two types of cell organelles. One, those which are wounded or surrounded by membranes, they're called membrane bound organelles, for example mitochondria and chloroplast. But there are a few cell organelles which are not surrounded by the membrane, called non-membrane bound organelles. The example of such organelles is ribosome, right? Okay, now let us understand first important cell organelle known as endoplasmic reticulum, right? You can take the screenshot, make your notes, look at the picture. Here you can see some membranes are originating from the outer membrane of the nucleus, right? These membranes are representing the endoplasmic reticulum of an animal cell. Here you can see this is the nucleus, right? And this is the outer membrane of the nuclear envelope. And this outer membrane folds outside and makes some flattened sac-like structures. So these all sac-like structures are representing the endoplasmic reticulum. This is again a part of endoplasmic reticulum. You can identify three different shapes of endoplasmic reticulum. This is flattened and sac-like structures. These flattened sac-like structures are called cisternae. Right, here you can see there are some tubular structures, so they are called tubules. Right, and along with cisternae, which are flattened vesicles, tubules, which are tube-like structures, there are some rounded structures or spherical structures. These are called vesicles. So what is endoplasmic reticulum? It is a network of membranes, or we can say it is a network of membrane-bound cisternae, tubules, and vesicles, which originates near the nucleus and may extend up to the plasma membrane. Now, there are two parts of endoplasmic reticulum, right? Or we can say two portions of endoplasmic reticulum. The portion of endoplasmic reticulum which is close to the nucleus has small particles attached on it. You can see small particles. These particles are called ribosomes. Dear students, ribosomes are called protein factories of the cells because they produce proteins. So this area of the endoplasmic reticulum, on its surface there are ribosomes, right? And because of these particles, the surface is rough. So this portion is called rough endoplasmic reticulum. And because there are ribosomes attached on its surface, we can say that rough endoplasmic reticulum is involved in synthesis of proteins, right? Now, the remaining portion of the endoplasmic reticulum, on its surface there are no ribosomes and their surface is smooth. So this is called smooth endoplasmic reticulum, or SER. So SER, on the surface of SER there are no ribosomes and there is no protein synthesis. But another thing is produced on SER, that is lipids. So function of smooth endoplasmic reticulum is production of lipids. Lipids are also called fats or oils. So fats or oils are called lipids and they are produced on smooth endoplasmic reticulum. Okay, another function of smooth endoplasmic reticulum, you can say the synthesis of steroid hormones. Right, steroid hormones are actually made up of chemicals known as steroids, and steroids are a type of fats or lipids, right? So some fats develop into steroid hormones that are produced on smooth endoplasmic reticulum. Okay, next, another function of endoplasmic reticulum is that smooth endoplasmic reticulum in liver cells, right, performs a very important task, that is detoxification. So many drugs and many chemicals may be toxic to the body, right? These all chemicals are detoxified or destroyed, we can say, on the surface of a smooth endoplasmic reticulum. So one function, we can say that function of endoplasmic reticulum is to produce proteins, lipids and steroid hormones. Another function is to produce to detoxify the chemicals, the toxins, the drugs, right? Second is that next function is that it provides surface for many chemical reactions. Okay, another function is that the endoplasmic reticulum acts as a channel. Here you can see that the endoplasmic reticulum is starting with the nucleus and going up to plasma membrane. So it acts as a channel for transport of materials. Some materials can transport through the plasma through the endoplasmic reticulum, right? So this is all about the function of endoplasmic reticulum. Now let's understand a little how does endoplasmic reticulum work. Look, this portion, suppose this is rough endoplasmic reticulum, RER, right? So proteins are produced on rough endoplasmic reticulum. Now these proteins either may be completely formed or formed, we can say, in their final form. Okay, so when they are formed on rough endoplasmic reticulum, they can be functional or they can be in their final form. So if the proteins and lipids which are produced on endoplasmic reticulum have acquired their final form, they can be sent to the different parts of the cell from endoplasmic reticulum, wherever these proteins and lipids are required. But if these materials are immature, right, and these proteins and lipids have not got their final form and function, if some work has to be done, if some modification and processing has to be done, right, then these proteins or lipids are packaged in small vesicles which are called transport vesicles. From these transport vesicles, these materials which are incomplete are sent to Golgi apparatus, right? Here you can see again the Golgi apparatus is made up of some flattened sacs. These are again called cisternae, right? So the materials are sent to Golgi apparatus, the proteins and lipids are sent to Golgi apparatus which had been produced on endoplasmic reticulum. Inside the cisternae of Golgi apparatus, these get modified and they can be sent from one cisternae to other for serial modifications, serial processing, and finally in the last cisternae or last part of the Golgi apparatus, these materials get modified completely, get their final form and function, and then they are again packed into the transport vesicles and then they are sent to their destinations. For example, they can be sent to any cell organelle like mitochondria, chloroplast, right? Or they can be sent outside the cell, they can be secreted outside the cell in the vesicles known as secretory vesicles. For example, you know that the sebaceous glands or the oil glands in your skin produce oil. So that oil is produced on smooth endoplasmic reticulum, then sent to Golgi apparatus for processing and modification. After getting the final form, they are packed into the secretory vesicles and then sent to outside the cell. The vesicles are membrane bound. These membrane fuse with the plasma membrane. This is representing the plasma membrane, and then the materials are secreted or released outside the cell. So in this way, we can understand that materials are produced on endoplasmic reticulum. They can be if they are in final form, then they are sent to their destination directly, and if they need to be modified, then they are sent to the Golgi apparatus in small pouches, where they get final form and then they are sent to their destination wherever they are destined, right? So this was all about the functioning and structure of endoplasmic reticulum, right? My dear, one important point I want to tell here, that these all membranes, you can see the nuclear membrane, the membranes of endoplasmic reticulum, the membranes of Golgi apparatus, the plasma membrane, or the membranes of other cell organelles, these all membranes are basically similar. These all are made up of lipid bilayer and protein. So this is all for this video. In this video, we have covered up the structure and functioning of nucleus and endoplasmic reticulum and brief discussion of Golgi apparatus also, right? Remaining topics will be covered up in the next video. Till then, keep focusing on your studies, give proper attention to your studies, do your regular homework, right? Revise the things properly. After watching this video, make your own notes from your NCERT textbook, or you can also take the screenshots. You can draw the diagrams which I have described here in this video. Thank you for watching video. Please like the video and subscribe to the channel.